Well, Richard Pratt, welcome to the platform. But in the end, Richard, it comes down to cardboard, doesn't it? Really, in the end, it's cardboard.
Packaging.
Yes. And what I want to know is what absolutely energises you around cardboard? What do you like about your job?
Well, packaging is used everywhere, and you compete with other people in their business. And one thing I must mention, I didn't do this on my own. I've got my son, two sons-in-law, and lots of great people. And it was because of them that the place was a success. Well, my job was just to buy the latest equipment and give them an opportunity to express themselves and do it right.
Yeah. And but are you pleased you're making something tangible like, you know, packaging, rather than sort of being in the money markets then? I know elements of your company are, but you directly, I mean, is it nice to make things?
Well, I wasn't smart enough to get into the money market, so I had to make boxes. It's a hell of a business. I remember once our manager decided to make coffins, cheap cardboard coffins. And my mother came to the factory and she looked at this and she said, "No, we don't make coffins." She was superstitious, perhaps, but
yeah, it was that's right. Yeah.
Going back
Everything
to the
else.
Old days.
You obviously had a great relationship with your parents, and you're the only child of...
No, there were two.
There two, yes.
A sister.
So. Oh, okay.
Who unfortunately died some time ago.
Right. And Leon and Paula, their names.
Yes.
Now, they were Polish immigrants. Yes. You came to Australia at the age of...
Four.
What's your first kind of memory of being here? Can you throw yourself back that far?
Yes, I went to a little school. It was near in Ackland Street, St Kilda, those of you who know Melbourne. And it was called Scots Church Kindergarten, Scots, T-S.
Yeah.
And my mother swore to the day she died that I went to Scots College.
What were they like? Because they started the business with other people. What lessons do you think you learnt from your mother and your father?
No, my mother was very generous. She was a good woman, and generosity has run through our family ever since. The more you give, the more money you make.
Mm.
That's quite a simple, easy thing to say.
Yeah.
But she was a good woman and a kind mother. And my father was a chess player. He was a master chess player. He won the championship of the Baltic States back in 1928. And he was a very smart businessman, but he wasn't very good with money. Mother was always fantastic with money, and she had the human touch. You could sit there and listen to her and marvel that she'd been speaking for 10 minutes and you couldn't understand a word she said. But it was all in good fun.
Yeah,
she wanted to entertain, she wanted to give what she had.
Yes.
She was a remarkable woman.
That's a great legacy. Your biographer, James Kirby, has written a very nice biography of you, but he also says at one point that you exhibit the classic behaviour in the sense of the outsider, that he puts down your great desire to achieve, your great hunger, your great ambition,
yes,
at times to being the outsider. Do you feel, or have you felt like an outsider?
Well, entrepreneurs all feel as if they're battling against the establishment, if you like, or battling against the competition.
Yeah.
And it's good to write on the wall of every business that you're in, who is the enemy? Where is the enemy? Because that inspires you. If you can identify who the enemy was, you've got something to fight against.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, too many companies, the enemy is inside, not outside.
Yes.
Who is the enemy? The people that worry about the fellow in the next office rather than worry about the outside world.
You've got a company, talking about sort of the enemy not being inside, you've got a company that's absolutely privately held, obviously.
Yes.
It's an extraordinarily big company to be so much in private hands. And you've talked a lot about making the inside of the company feel like a family. How do you do it? How do you get people that you employ, and you employ somewhere between more than 8,000 people, how do you get them to feel like a family?
First of all, I won't say I do it perfectly. And there are forces which stop anyone doing it well. But I get up at 5:30 or 5 o'clock every morning. I'm in the car and out to the factories at 5:30, and I wander through factories. I love factories. Love seeing what's happening. I talk to the people on the night shift or the day shift, depending. Today I went to 7 factories in Melbourne and Sydney. And it's what I love doing, and it's good for the business, and it does me a world of good. Mm. It boosts my morale to see people. Yeah. Occasionally somebody comes over and says, would you lend me $5,000? Which is normal. And,
what do you say?
I've got a problem. I say yes all the time. And then I hand it over to my finance people and they say, what have you done this time?
What do you like about the factory?
Well, it's alive. There are people, there's machinery working. And if it stopped, I'll have something to say about that. But things are happening all the time and you've got to see it happening, suggest improvements. They don't do what I suggest, but you suggest it anyway. And
some people who've worked with you, I remember one person saying to me that you are quite amazing because you can go into a factory or space and you can actually see a process and you can sort of see how it could be improved. Would you have liked to have been, it's sort of almost like a classic engineer approach to it, would you have liked to be an engineer, anything else that you would have, you know?
Well, an engineer would have set parameters on what I could do and what, I don't know what I'm allowed to do. So I take risks, I do things which are extraordinary, and I get away with it because people who get the idea use it as the framework for adding to it and subtracting from it and finally put it into shape that will work. Mm. Now, I won't say that's always the case, but it's the case often enough. Mm. And if I surround myself with people much more competent than I am, and I tell my people, I'm the only person in the company that employs people smarter than I am, because I'm not frightened of losing my job. Yeah. And I tell them, you should employ people smarter than you are so that you can get a promotion.
Yeah. Yeah.
And look, it's very important to surround yourself with, even your friends, amongst your friends, not only in business, mix with people smarter than you are and you'll get a bit smarter.
Mm-hmm.
If you mix with people that are stupid, they'll get smart and you'll get stupid.
Yes. you also say at one point in one of your speeches that you've said that you should never have any more than 7 advisors. What's so magical about 7 advisors?
Well, it's an odd number for a start, so you must get a majority. But 7 is about as many as you can cope with, otherwise you call everybody.
Yes.
Get everybody to advise you.
Yeah.
But limit it to 7 people that you're close to. Yeah. But you must have people that you can communicate with.
Yeah.
They mustn't always think the same as you. Mm. If I'm classified as an entrepreneur, you've got to have an administrator beneath you, immediately beneath you. This person must be able to put out the fires that you've created. And I'm an arsonist by nature. And fix it so that it works. And there's a wonderful, he's the most important person in the place, is that administrator, the bureaucrat.
Mm.
But on the other hand, you go around talking to people, going out and drinking grog with them and having fun. And you know, what an entrepreneur is known for. He goes away for a trip for a week and he comes back with 1,000 ideas. Mm. And like, oh, geez, here he goes again. And they all moan and
groan
because I'm the ideas person. But most of the ideas are not worth the paper they're written on.
What was your worst idea?
Coming here?
Richard's son is here tonight, so you know, and other members of the of the company, so they can.
Yes.
If you better fess up what your worst idea for business was.
There's not one idea, but it's usually associated with something which is far too small.
Yeah.
If you think small, you've got to push yourself to the boundaries. Push yourself.
Mm.
And some of the little businesses that I've started preoccupied our mind and we're worried about them, but they came to nothing.
What do you think your best idea has been?
Persisting, persistence, as I'll read you Kelvin Coolidge's quotation later, on persistence. But staying in our base business, which is paper, waste paper, craft mill in Tumut in New South Wales, southern New South Wales, and just sticking to the one thing, not going into blocks of flats or I haven't got a farm, I haven't got a boat, I've got a boat, but it's a little boat. And all these people
get... You've got a jet, though.
Oh, yes, but as a matter of fact, a mate of mine said if a chief executive or a chairman buys a jet in the company, he immediately sells his shares. Because it becomes a preoccupation. Yeah. I say to everyone that their family must come first. The family is all important. But the business must come second, not third or fourth or fifth, behind your footy team, behind your church, behind some other job that you take in government. Forget that. The business that you're in, the job that you've got, must come second after your family.
You also say that one of the things you must do is actually make decisions. What do you mean by that? Almost like any decision is better than none?
Yeah, it's true. We have a decision-making policy in our company. We sit a few people, say it's five or three or seven, around a table, put the problem in the middle of the table, and you can be sure within an hour or two they will have a solution. And that is our decision-making process. One person can have an idea, but he doesn't make all the decisions. I don't make all the decisions. They weigh my votes, they don't count them. But that's a different story. But if ever any company, whether it's private or public, has to make a decision, he has to get around himself, the smartest people in the company, doesn't matter what their rank is in the company, get around himself the smartest people and ask them, what are the problems, what are the opportunities of this decision? And you'll get the right answer from them.
Now, it is a very good story, but in the 1990s, Visy had its own near-death experience, didn't it, in a way, because of the problems. Will you just talk about how you got yourself out of a very low spot, in terms of, in a sense, the tactics, I suppose, rather than the numbers, but...
Praying? That's always a good solution. But we were up front, and we were prepared to put any money that we had, what the banks wanted, to get out of the problem. And it cost us $150 million, which we could not afford in those days. It was in the late 80s, I think. Mm. And we put all the money that we had available to us. There's at least one person in the audience that remembers that very well. Mm. I won't tell you who it is. But and we were helped by a lot of people that I wasn't especially kind to, but I fraternised with. There, again, this meeting people and greeting people and getting up and making a speech, singing a song, doing something that participated with the community. And as long as you're generous and honest, and my mother used to say, go up the straight road. Go up the straight road, never mind the twisty way. Go up the straight way. Just stick with that. And I had a lot of friends at that time that stuck with me.
Yeah. What did you feel like, though, for someone who'd been so successful and always going forward? What was it like at a personal level to, you know, really feel, you know, that the company was getting to real difficulties?
Well, I felt very bad, to tell you the truth. Mm. But one of the attributes a successful entrepreneur has is he can live with uncertainty. And that was a great uncertainty. And also you've got to have courage and you've got to be strong and you've got to have a lot of other attributes as well. But I think that was my personal relationship with a number of people Yeah. And I asked them for help and they gave it to me.
Yeah. I wanted to ask you a little bit too about the union movement, because the unions seem to be very happy with the way you do business. And that's not always the case with a lot of big companies. What's your view of how you work well with unions? And also, I'm wondering what your view of is with the current IR legislation, whether you have a view on what the Howard government is attempting to do?
Well, I think there are a few flaws in the union concept. For instance, we've got a lot of people who are on sick leave. It's not real sick leave, it's a bad back or a sore shoulder. Anyone who's really sick in our company, I look after them until death do us part. But there are a lot of malingerers, and they're on workers' compensation, and they're not fair dinkum, and I believe that we should pay a fair day's pay for a fair day's work, and if a person is sick, look after them, but don't look after malingerers. But apart from that, I don't think paying an extra dollar an hour makes a difference of a company of profit or loss. It doesn't matter whether you pay $20 an hour or $21 an hour, as we do in our industry, $22 an hour. It doesn't matter if you work time and a half and all the normal costs. Now, there are some people in the unions who have a different agenda. Their agenda is not to help the workers. Their agenda is in the old days it used to be communism, or the red flag, or I won't be satisfied till the red flag's flying above this building. Well, that doesn't rub with me. We live in a free enterprise, private enterprise system, and we should get on with it.
Yeah. What's your sort of guiding principle, though, about hiring people? I mean, how much... you're the entrepreneur, you own the company, you're always going to be incredibly fascinated by the company and very motivated, obviously. But what about people? How do you motivate some of people perhaps lower down the scale?
I find that the closer they are to the boss, and if the boss talks to them and brings him more into his confidence, the more motivated they'll be. Mm-hmm. So if you have a small company with 20 people, you can talk to everybody and take them out to lunch or dinner or anything you like. But when you've got 7,000 or 8,000 people, as we've got, it's very hard. And you try and push the message down as far as you can to integrate more people. Now, messages have got a transmitter and a receiver. And if either of those two things don't work, if you don't transmit correctly, if the other person doesn't receive correctly, you're going to have a catastrophe. And another thing, which I got from Coca-Cola, as a matter of fact, it's if it doesn't matter who gets the credit, anything is achievable. Anything is achievable if it doesn't matter who gets the credit. Therefore, you give the credit to the subordinate, so as many people as you can. Our company was helped by thousands of people who felt good about what they had achieved. Mm. Now, we try and have whiteboards and electronic devices all over the factory to tell people how they're going, what is their score. A lot of people don't do that. Mm. How would you like to go to a football match without a scoreboard?
Big problem for me.
Yeah, it'd be a big problem for everybody. If you went to a football match and didn't have a scoreboard, or a cricket match and didn't have a scoreboard, you wouldn't know how you were going. You know, approximately we're winning, approximately we're losing. Mm. That's crazy. Well, you've got to have a scoreboard, and you've got to have a measuring system which measures exactly what you... And that accuracy... I'm not talking about Six Sigma now. I'm just talking about... simple measurements. Measure how you're going every day.
So it's interesting because you said before that you're not an administrator, but you're obviously very interested in the detail, and you are a great micromanager in some ways, aren't you?
Well, these were ideas that I had that I saw somewhere, because nothing that I've ever said or done has been innovative. It's all other people's ideas. Mm. I'm a great plagiarizer, and I travel a lot and see a lot and talk to a lot of people. Mm. And when I think something's a good idea, it sticks in my mind, and I transfer it to my people, who laugh at it at first. They laugh less than, and eventually, after I give it about 2 years, it slowly creeps into the business through the back door.
Now, what's the biggest challenge, do you think, for Visy going in the next few years?
Well, we've got 8 companies or 7 companies. I'm not sure how you rate these companies. That are of substantial size. Every one of them, the manager of those companies, has to have a vision, has to see 6 years ahead. Where will he be? This is a question I asked them all a little while ago. Where will you be in 6 years' time? How much capital does the company have to put in to get you to where you want to be? And they all said 100 million, 200 million, a lot of money. But one thing they didn't quite satisfy me with was, and who are the young people coming up? Who is your deputy? Who is a fellow, the smart young man that is going to take over the company in 2 or 3 years' time? Because it's difficult to make a return of 15%, or on the EBITDA line, 25%. Mm. And it requires real skills, a lot of luck, a lot of hard work.
Mm. And does Visy remain privately held?
Well, as long as interest is only 8% or less, it'll always be privately held. Once interest gets too high, we'll think about
the alternative. Fair point. There's another fairly confronting issue, I suppose, that you might confront in the next couple of months, which is about the ACCC's investigations into the sector, into the allegations of price fixing in the cardboard box industry. Amcor lost its chief executive over it. You yourself at Visy stood down, I understand, have still stood down one of your senior people. Well, what's going on? Are you going to have to cop something from the ACCC over this?
Well, this is the law, and we obey the law. And I can't say much else because this case is not over. But the law of the land is the law of the land, and we must obey it.
Have you, you did an internal inquiry, I know, into Visy, and the reports were that not you personally, but the senior management were a bit surprised that sometimes people inside the company didn't really understand their obligations in this area. Are you surprised at that, and do you think you need a cultural change in some companies in Australia around things like, you know, price fixing and collusion and cartels, which would have been seen perhaps even 20 or 30 years ago as maybe just good business, you know. You do a deal, you strike a deal and on you go. I mean, is it a cultural change issue?
No, I don't think so. I think that most people knew that what the law was, and they chose to. But I don't know that any of our people did that. And there is a reason to believe that a lot of the allegations that were made against our people won't stand up.
And when are you expecting to hear?
Well, within the next few months.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I don't think the law takes a long time.
It's an important issue for you, and along these lines, isn't it? Because you have spoken out quite a lot on corporate social responsibility, and you put your money where your mouth is as well, obviously, with the Pratt Foundation and a lot of the work you've done around the research into water, and you've spoken out strongly about population issues. But, you know, it's quite tricky, isn't it, for a company to be in a situation where the corporate social responsibility work might be perhaps undercut if there are issues around that the ACCC takes up. I mean, how do you trade off those two things?
Well, you're talking about the press now, aren't you?
We're talking about you.
You really are talking about the reputation that you get from the press and you lose if the press decides to.
I'm interested in that. I mean, I think you have been very open about corporate social responsibility and those issues. What I'm saying is part of corporate social responsibility obviously is things like obviously, you know, obeying the law. And I suppose I'm just interested in wondering whether you worry about, yes, I suppose that, do you worry that your Visy's reputation is harmed by this sort of...
Yes, I am. Mm. Yes, I am. And I'll continue doing what I've been doing, whether we're harmed by it or not. Mm. We give away $10 million a year in donations to things. We support politics, we support football clubs, which are not necessarily donations. And we supported a $3 million, or it was a $9 million in the state and federal, put their $3 million each, mm. water program. Yeah. I'll keep doing that, irrespective. Yeah. And it's an obligation that I've got. That I came from the house of my father, and that's the way I've been brought up, and that's what I'll do.
Have you been disappointed by the federal government's or the government's generally response on questions like water? Do you want? Are you feel like we're running out of time on this?
No. No. It's. I was hopeful, and a little bit. I think I brought it to the attention of a lot of people. It all started with the population debate. I said $20 million. $20 million. People is not enough for a country the size of Australia. We want to increase by 1% in natural population growth and 1% by migration, which is 200,000 people a year. And I think we've achieved 120,000 people and maybe 100, but it's not enough. I can see is if we do increase by the same amount that we did from 1947 to 2005, that was 2% a year growth. Mm. And we went from 7 million to 20 million, and I think we'll go from 20 million to 50 million in 2050. Unfortunately, I won't be here to see it.
And just tell us what you want to do about water, basically.
Well, water, there's plenty of water. When you ask the people who run the reservoirs, the authorities, how much water did you let out today? They give you the figure in megalitres. And how much did you get paid for? And they go all quiet. And they don't want to say. Because they don't know. They don't know what amount of water went out of the reservoir and how much they got paid for. And that's terrible. Whereas, as I said earlier, there are ways of measuring that very accurately. If it goes out in a pipe, so much water flows through the pipe. And without touching the water of the north, the Fitzroy and Mackenzie rivers, we've got enough water in Sydney, and we've got enough water in the Murrumbidgee valleys, we've got enough water for the Murray, and we've got the legitimate claim that the environment has on our water. It's a legitimate claim. And that has to be factored into the argument. And we've done this survey, and there's plenty of water, but it evaporates. Mm. If you've got a swimming pool, do you know how much of that swimming pool evaporates in the hot weather? It's fantastic, the loss of evaporation. They lose up to 80% in the dry inland, and yet if it was piped correctly, the pipes could be made of plastic, and I don't make pipes. But plastic pipe. You know that story, don't you?
Yes, we do know that story. Good. All right. We might take some questions, I think, from the audience. And while
they've got these grapes, these wines, beautiful wine. I drank them, beautiful wine out there. Fellow from Taylor's is here. There he is. Pinot Noir. There's white wine, Pinot Grigio. They've just made one for 70-year-old people, and I've just turned 70. It's Pinot Noir.
We're definitely going to questions. if there is one from the audience somewhere. Otherwise, Richard, I'll just ask you one thing. We didn't talk about your acting career earlier on, but you did act in a very famous... I know you had a good role in a very famous Australian play that those of us of a certain age do remember, The Summer of the 17th Doll, and also that you went to London and you were on the stage in the West End. And it might sound like a silly question to someone who's been as successful as you in business, but do you ever have any lingering regrets about not having pursued the acting career rather than the family business?
No, I wasn't good enough as an actor. I didn't even know if I was good enough as a businessman, but it was a better bet, and I gave it a try, but I was sure I wasn't good enough as an actor.
Yeah, right, okay. Well, did ask Richard before whether he'd actually sing for us tonight, because he's renowned for singing at events, but he decided it was not appropriate in this right now. Anyone's got their hand up? My biggest problem sometimes is actually seeing down through the lights over here. Okay.
Robert Bozak, Richard. Your organisation, we've been talking about the opportunities in Australia. Do you see opportunities for your organisation to grow and develop overseas, and where are they, and what are the things that are holding you back there?
Well, we have some investments in New Zealand, for instance, in New Guinea, and in the United States, and Anthony is here today as testimony to the success of our overseas investments. And a friend of ours said to us one day, the only way you will succeed in America, it's such a huge market, it's 270 million people against our 20 million, it's 15 times as big as Australia, is if one of the family, either you or Anthony, come and live in America. And Anthony bit the bullet and he went to live in America, and he's made a great success of our American investment. Now, that is still not as big as Australia, and it will be eventually, but everything takes time, and it's a question of how much money we can borrow and how much good management we can find. But the formula is the same. Invest in machinery, the best machinery you can buy in the world, and meet lots of people, show them who you really are. This is me, naked, this is me. And slowly but surely, that business will grow. And Anthony's business is growing very well. Now, in the waste business, that's collecting rubbish from curbside, we're quite a long way ahead of the world. Germany has some excellent waste collection ideas and does it quite well, but we started about 25 years ago collecting paper to make collecting waste paper to make new paper with, and then turning that into corrugated boxes. Now our company collects 2.5 million tons of waste in Australia. That's about 1.5 million tons of paper and 1 million tons of plastic and glass and steel bottles, steel cans and aluminium cans, and glass is the second biggest after paper. But it's a huge business. Now we've got at the mouth of a waste recycling landfill. We have at the mouth of this landfill a building which is selectively sorting the trucks with a lot of paper and a lot of wood. Wood is used for fuel and pyramid to produce energy, and a lot of plastic. We put those aside, we tip them on the floor, and we pluck out the waste products. Now eventually, and we have a company that's dealing in robots, making machinery, eventually all that will be done with robots. The big bits will be taken out by the mechanical man. And eventually the other bits will be automatically removed. There'll be pushers and blowers and suckers and all sorts of clever devices. And now I could put that in any country of the world. There's not a country of the world that wouldn't be happy to have what Visy has developed in this waste collection and sorting business. Now, through the purchase of a PET company from Coca-Cola, we are obliged to collect as much PET as we can and turn that into food grade, it's important, PET and put a percentage of that back into the PET bottles that we make, PET bottles. Now, the aluminium, we sell to the aluminium makers. Alcoa, I think, buys that for $1,700 a tonne, and that's good money. And the steel manufacturers, the price has been up, but it's come down and it's gone up again. And they pay us $200 a tonne for the steel that we collect. And that's a great opportunity. But when you're looking for opportunities in Australia, there's lots and lots of opportunities in Australia. Queensland and Western Australia are the biggest growth areas because most of the population, the migration and the old people from Melbourne are going to Queensland and Western Australia. That's where I'm going. But the population does attract business, I must say. And New South Wales has been... Bob Carr said that he gets... 1,000 people a month, a 1,000 people a week coming into Sydney, but that's dropped off now to 30,000 a year, which is less than 1,000 a week, a month, or whatever it is. Another thing I can't do. But the opportunities in Australia are adding value to our resources and exporting our resources with automatic energy, automatic transport, automatic brains, intelligence into our exports. We export a lot of brains from Australia, and one of my plans was, in the population debate, was to create some jobs for expatriate Australians and bring them back to this country. Mm. There's something like 130,000, I think, of expatriate academics, people with that have found jobs in Saudi Arabia where they pay a lot of money. But we could use them here to help build this country. I say this unequivocally, that Australia, with its resources, its intelligent labour and the proper use of water, could be the great country of the 21st century, of this century. And I still believe that. But we've got to spend some money on infrastructure. And if I have any criticism of the country at all, it's we're obsessed with this. We're not allowed to borrow money. We mustn't have a negative balance of payments. But we should borrow money. We shouldn't send all our superannuation money to find equity opportunities for America. We should keep it here and use it in Australia. And all I ask is that the government guarantees a 4% return, and that would...
do the trick. Now, more questions. There's a couple here, so we'll take them.
Anatoly Kurievsky. Mr. Pratt, just follow up on your point regarding the workforce. You have seen young people enter your company for over a number of years, and I'm just wondering, how would you say the nature of the workforce that is coming in changed over the years? And also, what would you say you would like to see more of from the recent graduates from our universities?
Well, just to say that my father would never employ anybody who had a university degree. Absolutely. He said, how could I employ him? He knows nothing about life. He's been cloistered for the first 24 years of his life. He's been studying. Congratulations, he's got a degree. So what? What's his communication skills like? That has all changed. Good people are coming out of the university and they know how to communicate. They understand about life lessons. Life lessons are very important. And some people, in fact, take weekend jobs and they mix with grown men, some of them aren't as refined as you lot, but seriously, a university education is a must, but it shouldn't be necessarily put up the front. You can say, I've got other skills. I can do this, I can make decisions, I can talk, I'm a person in my own right. Give me a chance and I'll show you what I can do. And you can learn a trade very quickly. That's in a year you would know how to set up a machine, do this, do that, do the other. And you'd know all the jargon associated with paper making, box making, glass making, any kind of business. But these skills, to persuasive skills, to get people to do something for you, to communicate properly, to communicate up and communicate down. A lot of people can communicate up all right, but they can't communicate down. But we're still human beings. It doesn't matter what we know. We add that to our common sense. And common sense is all I've been talking today. If you ask me, I don't know anything profound. What I've learned is common sense.
Good. Now there's another question. It was just there as well, and one here.
You're leaning too much to the right.
Yeah. We'll be over there in a minute.
Sorry, Mitchell Taylor. You talk a lot about being an entrepreneur. How do you rate the entrepreneurship within this country? Do you think we're of world standard?
Yeah, I don't think there are a lot of people who are risk takers, if that's one definition of an entrepreneur. But we have enough entrepreneurs. Some that are successful, some that aren't as successful. And if you're going to encourage entrepreneurship, you've got to accept the fact that some of them will fail. That's part of the whole deal. But I think that Australians generally have got a slightly better percentage of everything. A better percentage of entrepreneurs, a better percentage of journalists, a better percentage of good ones, a better percentage of administrators. We've got the best bureaucrats in the world. And we've got, if ever any of you travel overseas, you'll find that we are a most desirable employee of a company, because when we go to England or when we go to another country, America for instance, the Australian works very hard to make himself, to build up his reputation in this new country. He works very hard. And he's intelligent. So we've got nothing to be ashamed of, but we should have a go and be persistent and try very hard to be successful. Because, as you know, there are a lot of forces which are trying to pull you down, trying to make sure that your left hand is more successful than your right, or your right hand is more successful than your left. But we've got plenty of opportunities in this country for people with a vision to see 6 years ahead, 5 years ahead, 10 years ahead. I can make it. You see, the three questions that I insist that my people ask themselves, what is really going on here? What is going on here? I know what is going on here, but what is really going on here? And then I ask the question, what is desirable? And then the last question is, how is it possible? What is really going on here? What is desirable? How is it possible? How is it possible to achieve my ambition? When you answer those three questions, you've got it all made. And the other part of a PhD, I've got 4 honorary PhDs, so I know what I'm talking about. The other part is, ask yourself the questions, what, when, how, where, and what have I left out? How, when, where? Don't ask why.
Who?
Who's going to do it? When's it going to be done by? Where's it going to be done? How is it going to be done? Don't ask why. Just leave why out of it.
Now, Richard, we've got time for 2 more questions, but you might have to be a bit brief. Then we've got time for 3, you see. But there's someone over here on the left who was keen to...
Thank you very much. Yeah. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity. Mr. Pratt, would you share with us your most scary, difficult experience that changed you your whole life, that made you a stronger person, and also that was a turning point in your life, if you may? Thank you very much.
Well, I've had a lot of scary experiences, believe me. Every time I nearly lost a customer, I got scared. And there's some truth in that. But you surround yourself with people that explain to you why the scariest thing in my life would be to lose through an accident or through death or through cancer or some medical, one of the family, my wife, my children. If that happened, I'd be devastated. I don't know for how long, but I'd be devastated. Now, apart from the health, nothing much scares me. I mean, if I get drunk one night and have an accident, that'd scare me. But usually, I don't scare so easy. I scare for a minute or two. See, when I go to bed, I'm always scared. I'm scared of what happened today, I'm scared of what happened tomorrow. But every time I wake up, and I'm really confident. I really believe that optimism comes from, I have an optimistic feeling. And there are reasons in business to be scared, but you've got to build around you a few people who are mentors, who love you, if you like, who will say to you, settle down, it's not the end of the world, you're healthy, you're well, your children are well, grandchildren are well. Be happy with that. And if you have those people close by, you can achieve a lot, a lot.
Good. A final question, I think, from down here. Says a...
Hi, Arjun Chabra.
Sorry, I can't see.
I was just wondering how much does succession planning now colour the current decision-making process? Obviously, with the children taking up the business, taking up new divisions, how much does that colour in your decision-making?
Well, until about 5 years ago, my idea of succession planning was I'll let them manage the business and I'll tell them when they can have a new car and I'll tell them when they can go on holidays and where they can go on holidays, and I want to know how they're doing and I want to know what their sales are daily, etc., etc. But about 5 years ago, I changed slightly, and I'm still in the process of changing. I've got four children, and three of them are in the business, and those three children have each got a large piece of the business. Anthony owns and runs America, and Alex owns and runs Thorny, which is a banking brokerage business, and Rafi owns the industrial side of the business. They're more or less $500 million capital in each of those three businesses. Rafi's business is a little smaller than the other two. And the main business, which is Visy, that's the main business, is still with the management, with the people who built it. The others, more or less, they built up themselves. And they continue to grow and they continue to do well. They use the company. The company has one balance sheet, and their ability to borrow and their ability to buy machines and so forth is still in the hands of, is still one company, and the audit is done by the same person. But they have the right to spend as much as they want to go on holidays wherever they want to buy whatever car they want to. And really, if you get to 70, you've got to say to yourself, what's the difference? So they make the decisions 10 years earlier. Time goes very fast. The days drag on a bit, but the years go quickly.
Now, Richard, on that note, I want you to read us this quote from Calvin Coolidge, one of your favourite quotes, and then we will have to, unfortunately.
Nothing in the world takes the place of persistence. Talent will not. Nothing is more common than unsuccessful men with talent and ladies with talent. Genius will not. Unrewarded genius is almost a proverb. Education will not. The world is full of educated derelicts. Persistence and determination alone are omnipotent. The slogan, "Press on," has solved and always will solve the problems of the human race. Kelvin Coolidge.
Thank you.
Good. Favorite.
Richard, thank you. And I just invite John Miko from Deloitte to just come to the stage and move a formal vote of thanks.
Thank you. Certainly, what a great evening, and I think we certainly got some fantastic insights tonight. Certainly, on behalf of Deloitte, we're very proud to be associated with the Meet the CEO series, and in particular, it's a proud moment to share the stage with one of our clients. So, thank you, Richard. Certainly, I think you can never underestimate, the value of listening to what successful people have done and what they've got to say. And I think tonight we've certainly heard one of the true leaders of Australia and someone who's gone about that in a very quiet way, but someone who's had obviously outstanding vision. And I'm not so sure whether I believe in the arsonist definition, but someone who's done some great things. Certainly, Richard, thanks again for your insights into Visy, but also I think some of the personal insights you gave us tonight. I found it very interesting that you, some of the insights around his family, coming from his parents, the master chess player being the strategist, and obviously from his mother around the money, people and philanthropy areas. So I think, as Terry said, it's been very interesting to see how, for a company founded just 50 years ago, it's become one of the major, packaging and paper and recycling companies. And I think that's a huge achievement in itself, but then to also do the amount of work that Richard's done in terms of philanthropy around commitment to arts, welfare, youth, Indigenous culture and environment is quite outstanding. So tonight was a great discussion. I think we heard such a huge range of areas from innovation and ideas, relationships, corporate social responsibility, business culture, employers of talent, use of technology, a whole range of issues, but probably the one that certainly got to me was having those dreams and thinking big. So again, hope you all have been inspired by what you've heard tonight, and thank you, Richard.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, we are going to draw to a close quite shortly, but before we do, I'd like just to provide our guests tonight with a small token of appreciation. Now, you'll appreciate that deans sometimes have tough decisions to make, but put yourself in the position of trying to figure out what to give Richard Pratt as a small gift. It did tease our minds for quite some time, but I am surrounded by smarter people than I, and they figured, look, just give him something recycled. And so that's exactly what we did.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Richard. And Helen, as always, will receive a small gift of flowers from us. The flowers tonight are donated by Roses Only, and they come with a very special significance. Everyone, of course, knows Roses Only. What everyone may not appreciate is that its CEO, James Stevens, is one of our alumnus. And he has assured me that he has individually identified each of these long stems as best of class, and he's combed Sydney to find them. Yes, indeed.
Enthusiasm is another important feature of business life. If you're not fired with enthusiasm, tell them they'll be fired with enthusiasm. Thank you very much.
In 2005, as you've seen, represents the faculty's 50th anniversary. We've grown enormously over the last 50 years as we've expanded both our disciplines and our programs. We're currently located in three different buildings across the faculty, across the university, in many cases in facilities with less than adequate teaching, study and research facilities. But all of this is about to change. In late 2007, we will move into a special building, purpose-built for our needs. This new home will provide state-of-the-art teaching and learning facilities and a focus for our schools, research centres, students and staff, all under one roof. I'm sure in Richard's terms he would describe it as the best equipment you can buy. Linked with this new building is a bold and ambitious plan called Bright Futures. Bright Futures is going to be an investment in people, programs and partnerships. Its objective is transformational change. Is such change necessary? I'd like you to be the judge. Access Economics recently reported that a university business education results in a considerable net benefit to the Australian economy. More controversially, it asserted that this benefit is higher for business graduates than those with non-business degrees. And finally, that business graduates can expect to receive higher average earnings over their working lives compared to non-business graduates. Well, on this basis, we might well ask, well, why bother changing everything? It seems to be going along quite well. But a very different picture emerges in an influential article entitled Bad Management Theories Are Destroying Good Management Practice. This article was written by a gentleman called Samantha Ghoshal, a very distinguished scholar, recently deceased. He's basically arguing that many of the worst excesses in recent times, and in the US, read Enron or WorldCom, in Australia, HIH or OneTel, basically arguing that these problems have their roots in a set of ideas that have emerged from universities and business faculties in particular over the last 30 years. He suggests that by propagating ideologically inspired, amoral theories, our universities are freeing their students and the future managers they become from any sense of moral responsibility. Now, this is a somewhat less comfortable place for a dean to be. There is certainly nothing as practical as good theory, implicit or explicit. It provides a powerful framework to guide behaviour and action. And whether you accept Ghoshal's argument or not, there is certainly no doubt that business schools and their scholars can and do have an impact, and that this can be good or bad. Business schools have a responsibility to their students, their stakeholders and their community to do good theory, to develop it, to test and to retest it, to teach it well, and to see it properly applied. The task of a dean and the purpose of Bright Futures is to create that environment here within the University of New South Wales, an environment in which these endeavours are recognised, encouraged, resourced and rewarded. Basically, the program will seek to underwrite engagement with all of our stakeholders on all levels, in the co-curricular life of our students, in our curriculum, and in our research agenda, to embed, if you like, the principles that have made Meet the CEO such a success in all of our activities. It identifies some of the big, difficult issues that confront our country and our region, and in partnership with significant others, will direct some of our effort to addressing them. For example, the efficiency and integrity of our capital markets and of our corporations, the economic, organisational and public policy implications of our rapidly ageing population, or the challenges of organisational and environmental sustainability, to name but a few. Obviously, we need to strengthen our capabilities in each of these key areas through strategic senior hires. We will enhance the quality of our students' teaching and learning experience and reward those who excel at this just as we do those who excel at research. And finally, we need to acknowledge our responsibility to develop future professionals, managers and leaders with a strong sense of ethics and social responsibility and a curriculum that enables this. We are a very fortunate community. Excuse me. We are blessed with more than our fair share of our nation's best and brightest scholars. We are blessed with more than our fair share of the nation's best and brightest business students. And we are certainly blessed with one of its most influential alumni. we have an opportunity to make a very real difference, to take a leadership role. The Bright Futures campaign sets the foundations for us to do this. With the support of our stakeholders, we plan to underwrite another 50 years of excellence in business education here at the University of New South Wales for the benefit of the university, Sydney and Australia. Now, that's, ladies and gentlemen, is where I want to leave the formal part of the evening. I do want to just make one final observation in closing. Before we arrived here this evening, my external relations department advised me that 40 of our postgraduate students were going on a sleep out. And I thought, oh, Jesus, what are they going to protest about, especially on an evening like tonight? That's just what I need. It turns out that, in fact, it isn't a student protest. It is a fundraising event, and 40 of our postgraduate students, including many of the volunteers here this evening, go from here to the Roundhouse to raise funds for the Australian Conservation Foundation. So as you leave tonight, you will observe a couple of volunteer collectors outside. Please take the opportunity to make a gold coin donation for the Australian Conservation Foundation as you leave. Thank you for your attendance this evening. Our next Meet the CEO is in September 15, with guest speaker Mike Hawker from IAG. I look forward to seeing you then.